Time after. I have found and I have learned, anytime God begins to position his people or a local church to begin to take land, we must work and continue to endeavor to keep the unity of God's Spirit in the midst of us. Endeavoring means we got to work at it. We got to keep our flesh under subjection. We got to keep the main thing the main thing. Amen. 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 So how many of you will do that? All right, praise the Lord. Brother Mays, we thank God for you. We want you to come, take your liberty, preach your heart out. How many of you are ready to hear the preaching of the word? Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise.
Somebody say praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's really give God some praise. Can we do it right now? In Jesus' name. God, we love you. God, we praise you. We magnify you, God. You are good. You are God and God alone. Now, blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. It's good to be back in Coeur d'Alene. Amen. Be with the Joneses. I love these people. Amen. If you don't love these people, there's just something wrong with you. Amen. Amen. That's all I can say. Praise God. Amen. I love them. Amen. You know, he's been a friend to us. If you don't know where I'm from Kansas City, so I'm about almost 2,000 miles from home, and I'm glad to have my grandson with me here. He was excited about coming with me. He's so excited he fell asleep. Amen. So he's not going to hear his papa preach, but amen. Amen. Just another day for him. Amen. Praise God. Amen. If you have your Bibles, if you turn me to Isaiah chapter 55, amen. It is good to see everyone here. It's good to be back. I've looked forward to this. Amen. I've looked forward to this for quite some time. And I appreciate, amen, Brother Jones opening up this pulpit to me. I do not take it lightly. And while I'm here, I'm under his leadership. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Amen. Isaiah chapter 55, verses 7 through 9. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Amen. God speaking through the prophet Isaiah tells us, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and God will have mercy, and God will not just pardon, but he will abundantly pardon. Ah, thank God. I'm glad. Anybody glad you've been pardoned this morning? Amen. Anybody want to be pardoned? Because it's abundant. It's abundant. Amen. Then he tells us that his thoughts are not our thoughts, and neither are our ways his ways. He goes on to say that as the heavens are higher than the earth, his ways are higher than our ways. And even his thoughts, they're not on the same level as our thoughts. They're much, much higher. And as soon as I thought on these three verses I just read, I realized that I wasn't even on the same level as God was. I wasn't even remotely close on any level spiritually, mentally, or intellectually. That's when I also realize that there are those times when God just doesn't make sense. When it's hard for us to understand, even harder for us to comprehend. So it's from these type of thoughts that I want to preach about those times when you realize that while God is there, and you know that he hears you when you pray, you just cannot make any sense of what he's telling you to do. So with this thought in mind, I just want to preach, just do it. Just do it. Just do it. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, just do it. Amen. Amen. Brother Jones, would you pray? Amen. I love you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Amen. Somebody clap your hands unto the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Woo, I love you, Jesus. My. Holy Ghost. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Have your way. I love you, Jesus. My. God bless you. You can be seated. I want to say one thing before I get started. I appreciate the Spirit of God that's in this house. And I know you don't need me to tell you, but this church ain't big enough. I mean, I ran around with the guys, and man, I thought, man, it's just too short. Amen. But I'll tell you, it's better than the first church I pastored. You had to run down the aisle and back up. That's all you had. Amen. Amen. But praise God. Amen. God is going to bless this church. I said, he's fixing to bless this church. Can somebody say praise the Lord? Amen. But I wonder, has anybody here beside myself ever experienced some type of a scenario in your life where God just didn't make any sense? Maybe you're thinking to yourself, well, I don't know if I want to answer that or not, because I don't want God, this preacher, and especially my pastor, to think I'm not trusting in him. Or that I'm doubting him. So I'm just not going to answer that. So maybe you thinking to yourself, I don't want to answer that because I don't want to sound unspiritual or even downright stupid. But I'm going to answer it for myself. I'm going to say, yes. Yes, there have been those times when God just didn't make any sense. Maybe I ought to clarify. There are those times when God's saying to me or telling me to do or telling me where to go or telling me what I shouldn't do or telling me where I shouldn't go. It just didn't make sense to me. In other words, it wasn't logical. It didn't fit into my how I do it box. I'm going to jump right into this message and say something right here. Most of the problem that the children of Israel had was with the fact that God so very often didn't make sense to them. Many times God directed them to go to a certain direction or do a thing that just didn't make sense to them. When God led the children of Israel out of Egypt, instead of taking them on the shortcut, he took them the long way around and he led them directly to the Red Sea. Now let's be honest about it. That just didn't make any sense. 10 different times, amen, the children of Israel angered God through their stubbornness and through their rebellion. It was basically because God didn't make sense to them. Numbers chapter 14, verses 22 and 23, God speaks and he says, because all those men which have seen my glory and my miracles, which I did in Egypt and in the wilderness, have tempted me now these 10 times and have not hearkened to my voice. Surely they shall not see the land which I swear unto their fathers, neither shall any of them that provoke me see it. Now, I'm no expert on this, neither do I claim to be real smart, but I have come to believe that the most important thing in the heart of God concerning his children is this. He wants to be believed. He wants to be depended on. He wants to be trusted, and he will do things, and he will direct his children to do things that just don't make any sense to them. It don't make any rhyme or reason to them. Can I hear an amen? sometimes I'm going to say that God doesn't make any sense to me when he's silent and when he's uncommunicative. Sometimes I can say that God doesn't make any sense to me because it seems he's not doing anything about the problem that I'm in. Sometimes God doesn't make sense to me because he will ask me to do something that hurts my pride or goes against what I believe is the right way. Because just like Proverbs 21 and 2 in part says, every way of a man is right in his own eyes. If the question is there ever a time when God doesn't make sense to you? My answer is not just sometimes, but most of the time. Did it make any sense to Naaman that he would go dip in a muddy river called Jordan and he would be completely cleansed from his leprosy? Did it make any sense for the children of Israel to get up every morning and go out and walk silently around Jericho except for the blowing of the trumpets of the ram horns once every day for 6 days and seven times on the seventh day, and then they were to shout? Did that make any sense? Did it make any sense for Peter to go fishing to get money to pay his taxes? Boy, I wish I could do that. Did it make any sense for Jesus to reach down in the dirt and make some mud with spit and put it in a blind man's eyes and then send him across town to wash his eyes off? Did it make any sense for Peter to simply throw his net on the other side of the boat after he'd fished all night and caught nothing? Did it make any sense for Elisha to cut off a stick and then throw that stick into the water and an iron axe head had fallen, expecting it to float to the surface? So I'm going to ask the question again. Are there times when God doesn't make sense to me? My answer is yes, absolutely. And I will even go so far as to say that most of the time, God does not make any sense to me. Let's go a little bit further. Does it make any sense to you that you can take a piece of fabric, pray over it, put some anointing oil on it, and when that hanky or prayer cloth is placed on someone, demons would leave them and their bodies would be healed? Does that make any sense? Does it make any sense, amen, that with your mouth you can say, in the name of Jesus, I claim the blood, and demons have to stop in their tracks, and all the demons in hell, they can't cross the bloodline? My God, I feel the Holy Ghost. You see, I've learned something about God. What we want from God is sense. Amen. There's something we can reason in our human mind, something we can understand, or even something we can reason out. But what God is looking for us is faith. I said, that's what God's looking for us. God is not a God of sense. He is a faith God. And walking with God is not a sense walk. It's a faith walk, or a walk of faith. Can I hear an amen? We have missed our greatest blessings and our greatest breakthroughs in our lives because we wouldn't do or say or go where and when God said. And we just say, why? Because it just doesn't make any sense. We want God to be logical while God wants us to be obedient. I said, we want God to be logical, but God's looking for obedience. We want God to explain everything to us before we move, but God wants us to move without him explaining everything or anything. You know, there's a possibility that there were some scientific equations and hypotheses that went into the walls of Jericho coming down. There's a possibility that scientifically, somehow the continuous blowing of the ram's horns and the single stored up shout created a massive sonic wave that disrupted the molecules that held the walls together and it fell flat. I suppose that's possible. But I want some. someone in this place to know that God didn't have a scientific conference with Joshua and explain to him all of the scientific details of his commission. God just told Joshua what to do, and Joshua just did it. And that's how God works. He gives the orders, no explanations, and he leaves it up to each of you to obey or disobey. Can I hear another amen? Brother Jones, it was possible there was some kind of healing ingredient in the mud of the Jordan River that attacked leprosy. I said, it's possible. But even if that was true, God didn't explain it to Naaman. He didn't explain it to Elisha. He just told Elisha, amen, to tell Naaman, and Elisha didn't even go out to greet Naaman, but instead he sent a messenger to tell Naaman to go and dip 7 times in the Jordan River. The point is being God knows all the logistics, why he does what he does and the way he does it and when he does it. But he doesn't require from us any type of logical agreement. He just requires faith and obedience. I believe that we're living in such a time that our very survival may hinge on the simple obedience to God's direction, even when they don't make sense. In the last 3 years, it seems like we have been on a roller coaster in this country. With COVID issues, the tumultuous presidential election, the storming of the Capitol, the rioting, the looting, and the thievery in many states, the immigration issues, the seemingly loss of common sense, amen, along with many other issues that are causing our heads to spin. Can I hear an amen to that? And many times, we haven't been able, amen, to make sense of what God has been doing, or could I say what he's not been doing. But I have some thoughts on this. It's just my thoughts, so please don't hold it against me if you don't happen to agree with me. But I believe God has been allowing us to feel that way, to bring us to a place where we can walk in simple obedience. God just calls that faith. I think God is saying, if you'll just trust me, I'll get you out of here. I'll get you through this. I know where I'm at. I know where I'm going. I know what I'm doing, even if you don't. Church, I wonder how many times we get aggravated at God because he's not keeping to our path that we've planned for him. We want to close our eyes and tell God where to go and what to do based on what we're comfortable with, what we're familiar with. But God wants us, in a sense, to close those natural eyes and just trust him and obey him, even when, and especially when he doesn't make any sense. If we ever get this principle down, it would be incredible, because we will realize that all it takes all the weight off of our shoulders. We don't have to understand the mechanics or the scientific principles of it. All we have to do is just do it. All we have to do is trust and obey. God said, told Moses, he said, stretch that rod out over the sea, Moses. And I can hear Moses now, but why, God, why? What's the logic behind that? And by the way, which end of this staff do I point out over the rod? How long do I have to hold the rod there? What's the angle I'm supposed to hold it at? Amen. How is my holding the rod over the sea going to affect the water? I want some specifics, God. How many of us are like that? But God didn't get involved in any of that. He just said, just do it. Fill the water pots with water. But they're asking for wine. They're not asking for water. Amen. Just do it. Just fill the water pots with water. I'll take care of the rest of it. I'm going to say something pretty big here. At least I think it is. As apostolic Christians, our biggest problem is not with the devil. Uh-oh. Our biggest problem is with why, God, why? When, God, when? And how, God, how? There's an amazing little chorus that says what we should be saying to God. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way. I'll say yes, Lord, yes, I will trust you and obey. When your spirit speaks to me, with my whole heart I'll agree, and my answer will be yes, Lord, yes. I'm asking this church, what do you do when God doesn't make sense? When he doesn't move the way you want him to move? When healing comes in stages instead of instantly? When the financial breakthrough seems like it will never come? When the job that you so desperately need doesn't seem like you're ever going to receive? When the children that you have prayed for and wept for and travailed over seem farther away from God than ever before? I'm going to stop here. I just feel like this. I don't know how many years ago. My wife probably going to have to help me, but I broke out with a rash all over my body. And through a process, I went to 3 different doctors. Nobody could help me. Well, except the last one. And I prayed, and it got so bad. I'm not trying to be too personal here, but I was traveling a lot then, and I would have to put a towel over the pillow because even my head was broken out. And I would literally, my wife, when I was home, she would grab my hand. She'd say, "Stop, you're shaking the whole bed." I was digging. And it was all over my body, my arms, my upper torso, my legs. And I prayed, said, "God, I need healing." And it wasn't coming. It wasn't coming. And I prayed and I prayed and had prayer. And every time I went to a meeting, every time I went someplace, I'd have the men pray for me. I need a healing. And it got so bad. It was horrible. And I finally, on top of all of that, I started having a problem with my heart, which led to my resignation as a pastor. And I went back to this, well, I skipped ahead, so let me finish this. I went to a doctor, and she finally was able to help me. And she put me on a medicine called Dupixent, and they took some, biopsy, thank you. They took biopsies and they come back that I had prurigo nodularis. What is prurigo nodularis? I'd never heard of prurigo nodularis. And so anyhow, she prescribed some medication for me called Dupixent. And the Dupixent did help. And in fact, I still inject every 2 to 3 weeks. Inject in my abdomen, and it has cleared me up, and I thank God for that. But then in the midst of all of that, I started having a problem with my heart. And I didn't know what was going on, and I went back to this gal, and I said, "Look, you got to do something. I got to get off this stuff because it's creating problems for me." She said, "No, it's not." She said, "It's not doing anything." She said, "It's not. There's nothing in this that's going to cause you a heart problem." I said, "All I know is ever since I've been on it, I started having these heart problems." She said, "You need to go see a cardiologist." I said, "Oh boy." So here I go off to the cardiologist, and the cardiologist, he told me, he said, he sat me down. He began to go over all my history. And I told him what I thought it was. He looked at the medication, pulled it up. And now he said, it ain't that. He asked me about my mother and father. Both of them were alive at the time. They both since passed. And he said, he asked me about my brothers and sisters. There's seven of us. And none of them ever had any heart. No, I said, not that I know of. And he asked me about my dad. Has he ever had, well, he's, you know, when he was in his 70s, he had a couple stents put in. Ah, that's nothing. He's scratching his head. He said, what do you do for a living? I said, I pastor a church. He goes, oh, no. That's high stress. I said, stress? What's that? But I'm telling you that just to say, amen, that when God didn't make any sense to me, when healing came in stages instead of instantly, amen, amen. What did I do? What was the correct response? I kept on praising him, and you keep on thanking him. You just do it. You acknowledge that he knows what he's doing. It's all under his control. You just do his, trust his timing. You just do it. The main thing is that we keep praising him because praise is the voice of faith. Just do it. Somebody say, just do it. You can praise and be raised or just complain and remain. Amen. Sometimes God says march. Sometimes God says just stand still. Sometimes God says be quiet. Sometimes God says shout with a mighty shout. Amen. Sometimes God says wait for the waters to part. And then sometimes God says step in so the waters can part. Sometimes God says run to the battle. And sometimes God says wait for the rustling of the mulberry trees. Sometimes God says go. Sometimes God says stay. Sometimes God says stop. Sometimes God says go, go, go. Sometimes God says yes. And sometimes he says no. Sometimes he says not right now. Sometimes what God tells you to do will be the most illogical move that could possibly ever be made. That's why it pays to have a pastor. I won't. Bless God. Maybe I'll hit on that again when I come back. Amen. Praise God. In Joshua chapter 3, the Jordan River was at flood stage, and God said, I'm going to get you all across. In my mind, I can hear Joshua saying, well, God, now that's all well and good, but I just want to know how you're going to do it. And God said this. He said, tell the priests that bear the ark, amen, to take off whatever type of covering they had on their feet, and with the ark on their shoulders, wade out into the raging floodwaters. Because Jordan was at flood stage that time of year. If you don't believe me, you can go to the Bible and look it. And then in verse number 13, God said, and it shall come to pass as soon as the soles of the feet of the priest that bear the ark of the Lord, amen, the Lord of all the earth, shall rest in the waters of Jordan, that the waters of Jordan shall be cut off from the waters that come down from above, and they shall stand up on a heap. Now, I can almost hear Joshua saying, God, that doesn't make any sense at all to me. I'm wondering, God, do you happen to have a plan B that we could consider? I imagine God said, Joshua, just do what I'm telling you to do. And Joshua obeyed. The priest stepped in and the waters parted and they crossed to the other side while the water stood up in a heap. I know. God help me. I don't know what crazy, illogical thing God might be asking of you. But I can tell you this, your miracle, your healing, and your breakthrough is on the other side of obedience, even when it doesn't make any sense. Somebody love him right now.
Musicians, would you come? I sure don't know who I've been preaching to today, but I do know that I have been preaching to someone in this place. And if you know that God has been talking to you, I want you to come to this altar. Come on, get up, stand up with me right now. Amen. I know God's been talking to somebody. I want you to come to this altar and cast your cares upon the Lord because He cares for you. I just want you to just do it. I want you to just obey. I want you to come on right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.